Newport Bridge, spanning the Saigon River on Highway 1, was the last the communists had to cross to enter the capital. We didn't know it then, but this was the last fight.
There's no way of shifting these people. 500 or 600 troops on this bridge, fighting probably a dozen or so, maybe 20 at the most, communists, and yet there they are, they've been there all today. Moment they panicked, and rightly so. The mortar hit right in the middle of the gun on the right, 100 yards away. It killed a lot of people. But now they've gone back to some of their positions. They've left one wounded in the road. Got this, and dead on the right.
They held the bridge a few more hours, but everyone knew this was the end. Saigon was about to fall. Soon the war would be over. As they pulled back, they brought with them a wounded Viet Cong, a young woman commando they had been fighting. Now the enemy, soon the victor. American embassy officials had promised an orderly evacuation for their own people, the foreign press, and for all those Vietnamese who had worked for them and might be in danger. The plan was for a helicopter evacuation from the embassy grounds, and the signal was Bing Crosby singing White Christmas over Radio Saigon. But somebody forgot to play it, and the embassy was stormed. So people fought and clawed their way over that wall, and they did fight and they did claw. The hysteria was infectious. From midday to past midnight, a constant shuttle of naval helicopters from the American 7th Fleet airlifted out of that embassy more than 5,000 people. The ambassador went on the final helicopter from the platform above his office. He was the last American to leave Vietnam. Aboard the US carriers waiting off the coast in the South China Sea, helicopters were arriving that did not belong to any ship of the fleet. South Vietnamese pilots had commandeered them and had flown themselves and their families out from right under the noses of the Communist Army. They joined the ranks of refugees aboard, but there was no room for their machines on deck, and so millions of dollars worth of helicopters were simply pushed overboard. The North Vietnamese Army entered Saigon just as they'd planned on May Day. Their journey had taken over 30 years, 10,000 days, and those of the world's press left behind in the city witnessed the triumphant arrival.
This is a historic moment, the arrival of the North Vietnamese regular army in Saigon, right in the middle of Saigon, just after 12 o'clock, just after noon. Here they are pouring down the main avenue. Further up there is the American embassy. At this end of the avenue is the former presidential palace, which President Chu left just over a week ago, and from which General Minh has today announced that he will unconditionally hand over to the new regime.
Their tanks had thundered down the length of Vietnam, all the way from Hanoi. Now they crossed Saigon's boulevards, and their foot-weary infantry plodded past the deserted military barracks. The people did not know whether they should cheer or weep, and they had yet to discover who was friend and who was foe. They had expected a bloodbath, but not a shot was fired that day and not a drop of blood spilt. The communist flag flew over, a Saigon renamed, To honor the man whose prophecies had led them here and who had died before he saw them come true, they called it Ho Chi Minh City. South Vietnam, such a short-lived nation, was finally toppled.